Well, thank you and good evening. Welcome to Washington, D.C. It's always a pleasure to be before the Border Trade Alliance because I feel like we've got so much in common working on issues that are so important and vital to border communities all throughout our border region and really our two border regions. So I wanted to thank you for inviting me to be here, and especially thank Maria Luisa for including me as part of your conference here. I had a chance to look over your agenda, actually flying on the plane here today, and you've got some very important speakers lined up that I hope you will take full advantage of their being at your conference so that we can get them to help better understand the challenges that we face as border communities and also get their assistance. There's a lot of things happening right now at the federal level. One other little thing that's going on, which I think maybe all of you know about, it's called a presidential election year. So it's a good opportunity to get people to focus in on the issues that are important for our business community, trade and commerce of our efforts to include three countries in all this. I know that one of the big issues that we've been wrestling with, because I've been wrestling with it, are the wait times at the border area. Over the course of the last year, we've really looked at working to try and address that issue. There are some good news and some bad news on this. The good news is that working with DHS and working with the leadership of DHS, we've been able to work on as much as we can because they have some limitations as far as staffing and also infrastructure. We've been working with them to try to help us address that. And so we've made some progress where people were complaining to me about 2 hours, 2.5 hour waiting to cross back in our particular district. That's been reduced now to 45 minutes to an hour. Not acceptable at all in terms of what our target should be, but certainly much better than it was at 2 hours and 2 hours and 30 minutes. So there's much more that needs to be done there. And I'll tell you in a minute about something that I think will help address that here in the not too distant future. But just to give you as an example, El Paso, we average about 95,000 crossings on an average day in El Paso. So there's a lot of movement back and forth. And all of these people moving in our community are limited by the number of places where they can cross. In our case, they're limited by the bridges that are in place. And so we get this stress and this pressure on our infrastructure that affects our economy because it affects our trade going back and forth. It also affects our communities, our extended community, our region, because there are a lot of people moving back and forth. I know we have 16,000 or so students that are coming in every morning to go to class in El Paso. So these are challenges that are important that we communicate to other members, both representatives and senators up here, so they can understand the pressure that our communities are under when we don't have an infrastructure that supports that capability. And we don't have the staffing under DHS that provides the agencies responsible for our security. And believe me, having spent 26 and a half years in the Border Patrol, I'm not asking anyone to relax security, because security has to be one of our top priorities. But there's a way, I think, that working together, that we can address the issue of security and tie that in with our ability to continue to pursue good economies on both sides of the international border. And our communities have thrived and lived because we've had this transparency between us for decades and decades. And now since 9/11, because of the challenges that we're now facing under the security requirements, we're having to make some adjustments. But those adjustments that we make can be made with the understanding that nobody gains anything if we worry exclusively about security, and therefore nobody moves back and forth. The transparency is gone. The ability of people to move back and forth, trade, commerce, tourism, and the culture that we as members of the border community, fronterizos that we call ourselves, literally evaporates. So we've got to find a better way to do that. There are a lot of challenges that we face on both borders, the southern border and the northern border. And one of the biggest challenges is educating those that are making decisions or are in a position to make decisions without having the intimate knowledge that all of us that live on the border even take for granted. So that's where your group, the Border Trade Alliance, becomes an important and pivotal part of looking for these solutions up here. That's where your ability to put on conferences like this, because we can marry these kinds of conferences with the efforts that we've got up here. We've got a border conference every year here. Since I've been in Congress, we've had one every single year, and that's intended to continue this education process. That's a very important part of the puzzle that we're trying to solve here. So your conferences here, the number of members that you attract are vitally important. And you may think that you're preaching to the choir, but in reality, that just reinforces our message that border communities are unique, that border communities are in a unique situation that need specific attention at the federal level. And when I talk about the federal level, I talk about all federal levels, the U.S., Mexico, and Canada as well. So you play an important and pivotal part in this effort up here. I want to bring you up to date because today I introduced a bill that we think over the course of the next 5 years will give us the ability to address the shortfalls that we have seen building up the last few decades, and certainly that have been bubbling up since 9/11 because of the issue of security and because of decisions that are being made by Secretary Chertoff and members of the administration in order to address concerns that Americans all around the country have about, are we safe? And we, every night, including tonight, I might tell you, we hear that constant drumbeat of pundits that say, we have a border that's out of control, we have a border that's broken, we have a border that's in chaos. Those of us that live on the border don't recognize the way it's described by these people. So it's a real, it adds more challenge to us to be able to make sure that a clear message gets across to people that are in a position to help us. People like Secretary Chertoff, Commissioner Basham, and others in the Department of Homeland Security. People like Secretary Gutierrez and Deputy Secretary Negroponte, that are interested in making sure that the relations that we have internationally, not just with Canada and not just with Mexico, are ones that we can all benefit from. So we have the ability to influence these decisions. But more than that, I think we have an opportunity by making sure that everyone understands the challenges to do a better job. And that's where I think the legislation that I want to talk about today comes into play. The legislation that we introduced today addresses multiple challenges as it applies to security, as it applies to commerce, as it applies to the ability of us to have a transparent border. First and foremost, it calls for the hiring over the course of 5 years of an additional 5,000 Customs and Border Protection inspectors. Very important because right now, when we held a hearing in El Paso, a field hearing on the wait times, that was testimony that came across very clear that Customs and Border Protection is under tremendous stress because they can't keep the lanes open because they don't have adequate staffing. So this legislation adds 5,000 additional Customs and Border Protection inspectors. From my experience, whenever you pass legislation and you leave it up to the agency, these positions often get siphoned off to other areas. So what we have included in our bill is an additional 350 positions that we have designated for support. You might wonder, why is that important? Because these are the positions that go to the clerical staff, that go to the secretarial staff, that go to those that are non-officer, but yet very critical. And if we don't designate them that way, then what they'll do is they'll take officer positions and convert them over to support staff. So we've got 350 slots that will go under this legislation to the ports for support staff. In addition to that, because of the challenge that we have faced, and a lot of us have heard many people complain about our inability to make sure that we have an adequate inspection process, to make sure that the food that we're importing, the agricultural products that are coming into this country, are safe for consumer consumption. So we've included an additional 1,200 agricultural inspection specialists that would be assigned to the ports of entry. When we were getting ready to understand exactly what kind of legislation we needed to propose, I spent many, many hours talking to the officials at DHS, and I spent a whole morning understanding the challenges that they face in terms of the many ports of entry and the condition that they're in terms of their infrastructure. One of the points that they made was that when we had the legacy programs combined after DHS was created, we had Customs, we had INS, and then we had agriculture. Well, agriculture never had enough filled positions, so we're giving them 1,200 positions that will specialize in that area. In addition to that, we have tasked GSA, and I invited and had the GSA Commissioner Dong, come to El Paso and look at the challenges that we were facing and the delays that were being created by inadequate staffing, by infrastructure challenges, and by some of the temporary construction that was going on. So in this legislation, it provides for $1 billion to be given to GSA for 5 years, so that's a total of $5 billion, to address ports of entry. The Department of Homeland Security has a study that they have that they showed us and they have completed that prioritizes the different ports of entry in terms of the challenges that they face by lack of access, in some cases where traffic has to cross over, trucks have to cross over vehicular car auto traffic to get to their inspection station. So this money is intended to be utilized to construct, to remodel, and to address infrastructure issues along both both borders. I've talked extensively, and in fact, Chairman Benny Thompson, who chairs the Homeland Security Committee, has been very helpful to us. And I should tell you, he's from Mississippi, but let me tell you, he's a very quick study. He really gets the fact that if our goods don't get through the ports of entry, it impacts places like Mississippi. And so he's been very helpful. He's been very understanding. In fact, he was gracious to do that field hearing in El Paso in January, so we could have public testimony on record to be able to justify this legislation. So we think we've got a very good bill. We think we have a bill that addresses the issues. It is going to, as all of us I think recognize, it's not something that anyone can wave a magic wand and say, man, all our problems are instantly solved. But it does merit a consistent long-term commitment from the federal government so that they operate at optimum capacity at the Academy for Customs and Border Protection, so that they hire the inspectors that they need, so they can open up those lanes, so that they have adequate support personnel, so that they can have and guarantee us that the agricultural products that are coming into this country are well inspected and will be safe for consumer consumption. It's a piece of legislation that I'm very proud of. I think we're not going to have any problem getting co-sponsors. But here is tonight the challenge that I give you. The challenge is to make sure that on a collective basis, we work on getting support for this legislation. That we get that support so that there is a commitment. As we are, I'll mention it again, we're in a presidential election year. So the bulk of the work that is being defined in this piece of legislation will fall on the next administration. So this is a good time to get members of Congress, representatives and senators, to come on the legislation. This is a good time to, as we get an opportunity to make the pitch to the candidates that are running to be the next president, who will have the responsibility in their administration of, once this legislation passes, of carrying it on through fruition. That, in a nutshell, is what I wanted to communicate to you this evening. And to tell you that together we can make great progress. Together we can educate people about the challenges that our border communities face. Together we can make the case about the impact that decisions that are made for the right reasons, decisions that are made because people are concerned about security, people are concerned about our ability to monitor our borders. And people know that we've made a commitment to do the Secure Borders Initiative, which is the Border Patrol piece of this. This is the companion piece for the ports of entry. I think it makes sense. I think it comes at a good time. And I think that together If we work hard and if we get additional support, that we can make this happen. So with that, I want to again thank you for giving me this opportunity to be here. I want to ask you to please help us get people to support this legislation. It's got a catchy name. It's called the P.O.R.T.S Act, and that stands for... Putting our resources, where is it, Kira?
Towards security.
Okay, here it is. And this is why we have great staff. I said, listen, we need to have a catchy phrase to push this. And so they said, okay, they gave me a bunch of options, and we decided that this one made sense. Putting our resources towards security act. And when you take the initials, it spells P.O.R.T.S Act. So easy to remember, right? So thank you all very much.
Thank you so much. I think I can clearly say that we will support you. All my board members are here, and we will support your legislation. We will work together with you and with your staff in terms of gathering support. Today, I think we heard from all the border communities, from the northern border and the southern border, that the biggest problem was staff and resources. And of course, you have, for example, the legislation introduced by Congressman Dingell, where he wanted to close all the ports of entry to handle food coming into the country because there was not enough agents. So this is really addresses some of the issues. So thank you so much for your leadership. So count with our support
thank
from that respect.
Much.
Thank you, Congressman.
Thank you all.
Thank you.